Does anybody have any announcements to share this morning? We have, don't want to forget that Family Altar is to pray for a nation, elected officials, law enforcement, first responders, our forces, teachers, school staff, administration, healthcare workers, caregivers, farmers for safe and successful harvest, all churches and all God's children. And after talking to Karen this morning, I think we should be lifting up the nurses in the schools specifically there. So dealing with a lot of things and that Karen was telling me about. So we want to make sure that we lift up in prayer all the nurses that are involved in the school system. So let's see, one of the things I wanted to share on the back of the bulletin with everyone, and this was on Facebook, it was kind of good. When you learn how to sit at the table of your Judas, you'll understand the love of Jesus Christ. And so I think that's something that when Ann read it to me the first time, I was like, huh, say it again. But it's something you got to think about, and especially that first part. When you learn how to sit at the table of your Judas. And so just kind of think on that for a while. Also, we're going to, with the numbers changing and stuff like that, we have a thing in here that Ann came up with, and I just want to share that with all of you in our announcements. The Indiana mask mandate has been extended for another month. One of the exemptions to the mandate is, and anyone attending religious services as parishioners should already be maintaining at least 6 foot distance from one another during the services. From Executive Order Exemptions -37. We have plenty of room for 6 foot distancing, but we'll require masks if that becomes an issue later on. And if you do not feel well, we ask you to please stay home. So we're trying to apply, you know, to all the different mandates, and so I think we do a good job. So just a reminder is what that's all about. So we want to keep everybody safe. I think that's all I have this morning. Oh yeah, and well, yeah, I saw you had it up there, but it's not on here. But we want to remind everybody: next Sunday is to fall back, turn the clocks back an hour, and so it's that's coming up. And so I'll still be traveling to work in the dark, and still coming home in the dark. So it really doesn't mean anything to me. So for all of you who are going to earlier than a little later than I am, it'll kind of make a difference for you. So let's call to worship. Father God, it is such a joy to be in the house of the Lord. It is such a joy to be in the very presence of God. Father, we're going to hear a little bit later in the scriptures about the very presence of God with us here today. And that's what the Holy Spirit is all about, the third part of the Trinity. God exists here in the hearts of those people who have accepted him and asked him into their lives. And so, Father, we just thank you this day as we come before you in holy worship that you are with us and you can enlighten us to the words we hear and the songs we share and all of these things about sharing our praise and glory for our God. And so, Father, this day we ask you to open up our hearts and our minds and let us feel the very presence of our God, so that we can be changed in a very powerful way, that we can go in which we live and share the blessing of Christ Jesus with others. So, Father, we ask you to show us as your people on how to apply your word that we hear today in the communities and that we live in our homes in which we stay. So, in Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Let's all join together in a call to worship. Dear Lord, we most humbly beg you to give us grace not only to be hearers of the word, but doers also of the same.
Not only to love, but also to live.
Not only to favor, but also to follow your godly doctrine.
Not only to profess, but also practice your blessed commandments.
To the honor of our holy name, and the health of our souls. Amen. Our first reading today is Thessalonians. And we will be, reading from the second chapter, verses 1 through 8. And let's hear the words of Paul this morning. And I think that would come out of me in reading this passage a little bit different today was about seeing the change that happened in the disciples. And so let's hear that message for us. You know, brothers, that our visit to you was not a failure. We had previously suffered and been insulted in Philippi, as you know, but with the help of our God, we dared to tell you his gospel in spite of strong opposition. For the appeal we make does not spring from the error or impure motives, nor are we trying to trick you. On the contrary, we speak as men approved by God to be entrusted with the gospel. We are not trying to please men, but God, who tests our hearts. You know we never use flattery, nor did we put on a mask to cover up greed. God is our witness. We were not looking for praise for men, not from you or anyone else. As apostles of Christ, we could have been a burden to you, but we were gentle among you, like a mother caring for her little children. We loved you so much that we were delighted to share with you not only the gospel of God, but our lives as well, because you had become so dear to us. Let us pray. Father God, let us hear the words for us this day on how we can be loving, even when we feel that we are going into a hostile situation. Maybe it is something that we are called to do, is to make a difference. Maybe it's something we're called to be more Christ-like, because we are not to please men, we are to please God. So our lives should be that of seeking the knowledge of God so that we can take the message of God through the gospel of Jesus Christ. In which we live. There's a very powerful message for us on how change the disciples. Even after they were turned away, even after they suffered, they still continue to bring the message of Jesus Christ. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. I think when I look at this passage, there's some things that we need to recognize in here. We had previously suffered. As you know, with the help of our God, we dare to tell you his gospel. And so we got to think about, put ourselves in the disciples' situation in this part right here. We got to sit there and think about how they went into Philippi to share the good news of the gospel. They were to share the message of Jesus Christ. And they went into Philippi and they were insulted. And they were persecuted. They were turned away. And this would have... This message suffering that they would have had would have went to where we are in Thessalonica. And so this message would have gotten over to them. And still, the disciples, even though they were insulted in Philippi, they dared to tell you his gospel in spite of strong opposition. So when we sit there and look at that, we can see that the disciples had already expected to when they got to Thessalonica. And the thing to remember is what we're kind of hearing here is this is a letter to the church of Thessalonica, the Thessalonians, the Christians. I don't want to say the Christians, but they're bringing the message right now. But there would have been some who would have accepted this message. So we need to take that this opposition that they were faced in Philippi was where they were expecting to face the same thing when they got to the church of Thessalonica. And so now they go there and they say it's not because of what they did or the strength that they have or that it was because of what God was doing in them. And so they dared to tell them of the gospel. And so they weren't about to let men turn them away from sharing the message of Jesus Christ. So it goes on to say in verse 4, it says, we are not trying to please men, but God. And so what they're trying to do is here is to reaffirm their mission. And that means I'm not bringing the message that the Pharisees or the Sadducees or some other religious faction was bringing is that they believed that this was the very message of God. This was the gospel, the message of Jesus Christ. And so they're saying that we are not coming as ordinary messengers of God, messengers of Jesus Christ. And it goes on to say, as apostles of Christ, we could have been a burden to you. I want to stop right there. I think what this means here is we could have been a burden to you, meaning they could have been very harsh, meaning very direct, very insulting, let's say. They were insulted in Philippi. They could have been very insulting of the church in Thessalonica because of the way that they were worshiping. And so they're saying a burden to you. But instead of being a burden, he said they came, we were gentle among you, like a mother caring for her little children. So I want you to kind of think about that, is that sometimes our children can push us to the limit. Meaning, you just want word that came into my mind, I guess I should share that, is retaliate. You know, you just kind of want to, you know, come back in a certain way, but in a sense, you just kind of understand as a mother caring for her child that you have to make it a teaching moment, an understanding moment, a sense that they're not quite intelligent enough or mature enough to understand what's going on in this situation. So as a mother caring for a child and what that child is doing, the disciples were doing for the church in Thessalonica. In other words, they were understanding that they weren't mature enough in their faith to understand what they were doing. And so they came in a very caring and mature and a loving kind of way, as a mother loves her child. And so when you sit there and think about that, they came into the church of Thessalonica in that way and said, we loved you so much more, so much that we were delighted to share with you not only the gospel of God, but our lives as well. So I want you to kind of think about that for a minute. This was not a sense where they just came into the church of Thessalonica and they shared the message of God and then they just went off into the sunset. This was a message where they gave every part of their very life to bring the gospel to the church of Thessalonica. In other words, it wasn't that they just cared for them, but they gave them their life themselves. In other words, they cared so much for the church of Thessalonica and the people of Thessalonica that they came into there and they wanted to share their very own lives. See, now I think this is about building a relationship. Building a relationship with the people within the church that you can both understand where you are coming from. Like I can understand where you are in your faith and you can understand where I am in my faith. Church of Tefft, United Methodist Church, can share in the faith of the sorrowful mother, the Baptist Church in Wheatfield. In other words, we can care so much that we want to share our lives and care about each other's souls, care about each other's needs, desires, that we give our lives for each other. In other words, in sharing the gospel of Jesus Christ. In other words, we're bringing a unity instead of a division in the community. And that's what I believe the gospel is all about. I believe that this is Jesus's the very strong message for all of us. And that is, he came and died for all of us, that we are to come together in sharing the message of Christ. And that means sharing it in a very powerful way, as to sometimes give our own lives to show how much we care for the life of others. Let us pray. Father God, when we see the message of Jesus Christ, when we see the love that he had for all of us, when we see our mission here in the church in sharing the gospel, as not as pleasing other people, but as being like a mother caring for a child and just sharing the gospel as God has intended us to share, then we can be a powerful source of bringing the message of Jesus Christ. Okay. That we, as faithful followers, we, as people who have gathered to hear your message today, that we can take that as part of our life and take it out into the communities and into our homes and let people see the message of Jesus Christ that he has entrusted to us. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. We all stand and join together in our hymn. Oh, it's not on here.
Oh,
pass it on. Pass it on. Huh? Oh, there it is. I was looking to the other song. Pass it on. Father God, we take just this moment of silence, to allow those who have joined us at home and on Facebook. We ask you, Lord, to hear their prayers. Father God, it is such a joy to be in the presence of our God. And Father, when we can look at the good news of Jesus Christ and the works of Christ within our life, And we can see it as something that we do want to pass on. Something that we are not to hold back, something we are not to hold on to, but something that we are to pass on and to share with others. Father, we just can see in our lives very much how we are to look at the letter to the Thessalonians and see how we are to, no matter what opposition or what struggle or what suffering we may have gone through in with someone or something or some church or whatever it may be, if we can look at that as the message, as the persecution and the suffering that the disciples received in Philippi, it did not keep them from sharing the message to the church of Thessalonica. And they expected to be persecuted. They expected these things to happen, but still they were driven by your word, by the power of our God, to go into that situation and share the gospel. The same message is for us here today, that no matter where we are, no matter where we are going, the travels that we are on is to share the message of the good news of the gospel. And so this day, Father, we ask as we hear the scriptures and we sing the songs that we can see it and see the gospel in a new light, in an enlightening light. See that it is something for us to pass on. It is like spring, it's fresh, it's blooming, and we need to share that good news of the gospel of Jesus Christ. So Father, this day, we pray that we can receive your message as flowers blooming and the skies just opening up and brightening and new life coming into our bodies and our souls and our minds. And as we see that new life, we can see how important it is for us to just share the good news. So Father, today, as we stand here receiving the blessing of your light, we want to lift up all of those that were mentioned to you this morning. We pray that you are with us on Facebook Live. We pray that you hear all of our prayers together as men and women coming together to hear and to share the message of Jesus Christ. Father, we want to thank you, and we ask for your blessing to fall upon the hands of those who continue to give to the church, so that your mission, your word, your gospel can be shared to throughout the community. And so, Father, we ask you to continue blessing those who are giving to the church. Father, we ask you to be there in each one of those situations that were mentioned this morning, that those people who are going through suffering, whether it be an illness or an injury, whether it be military men and women overseas or be the suffering of their families here at home and that separation of their loved ones. There are all kinds of different sufferings within this world. But Father, we want to continue to focus on you, to continue to see your strength in amongst all of this adversity. So Father, we thank you and praise you for the gifts that you have given us. And we pray, Lord, that you hear this in prayer that you taught us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. Good drink. I had a little tickle going there for a second. Gospel reading for today. We're going to continue in Matthew where we were last Sunday. Excuse me. We'll be reading from chapter 22, verses 34 to 46. And this is where the Pharisees kind of come before Jesus to ask him a question. And if you remember from last week, it was the the disciples of the Pharisees that were asking Jesus the questions. And so now today we have the Pharisees themselves going before Jesus. So let's hear the Jesus' response to the question is, what is the greatest commandment? Hearing that Jesus had silenced the Sadducees, the Pharisees got together. One of them, an expert, asked him with this question, "Teacher, which is the greatest commandment in the law?" Jesus replied, "Love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, with all your mind. This is the first and greatest commandment. And the second is like it. Love the Lord, love the, your neighbor as yourself. All the law and the prophets hang on these two commandments." While the Pharisees were gathered together, Jesus asked them, "What do you think about the Christ? Whose son is he?" "The son of David," they replied. He said to them, "How is it then that David, speaking by the Spirit, calls him Lord? For he says, 'The Lord said to my Lord, sit at my right hand until I put your enemies under your feet.' If then David calls him Lord, how can he be his son?" No one could say a word in reply, and from that day on, no one dared to ask him any more questions. Let us pray. Father God, let us hear the message in Matthew. Let us see who is the Christ, who is the Messiah. Jesus is the Messiah. Jesus is the Christ. Jesus is the one who has come into the world. Jesus has been anointed by you. Father, we praise you this day for the glory of our God in Jesus Christ. And we pray, Jesus, that we receive your message. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. light jumped out at me. I always say there's one of them right there. Let the church live loud. Are we living loud? Do we confess what we believe? Do we believe? That's my question for all of us. I sit there and listen to the song, and if you listen to it enough and you kind of look at what he said there, in the beginning it starts out, in this time of desperation, when all we foundation. So I want you to kind of think about that in the situation that we're all going through right now with the pandemic, and it's been going on since, you know, a lot longer than that, but really the effects of it, you know, for all of us has been since last March, that kind of thing. But we are living in a time of desperation, at least for some of us. And we are, we all know, when all we know is doubt and fear. And I think that's a lot of what's going on, is there is a lot of doubt and fear that's going on. Doubt and fear about tomorrow, about doubt and fear about what's to come, doubt and fear about, you know, who's going to be the next one, maybe in our family, maybe in our community, you know, someone we know or love very much. Maybe it'd be an elderly person in the life. Maybe somebody, you know, get the COVID-19. Where there's a lot of doubt and fear going on. But if you go by this song and you listen to what's going on there, it kind of takes some progressive steps. And the progression of these steps that's happening in here is that of bringing hope and getting in the mindset. And that kind of comes towards the end. And it's in this time of desperation, when all we know is doubt and fear, there's only one foundation, and that means that we have to build our life on the foundation of the gospel of good news of Jesus Christ. We have to build that foundation on the strength and the power of our God that came to us in the Messiah or the Christ in Jesus Christ. And so in this progression that we see in this, it kind of takes different things about changing thinking, and that of where it goes on to say, there's only one foundation. We believe in God the Father, we believe in Jesus Christ, we believe in the Holy Spirit, and He's given us new life. And so, I wanted to is kind of talking about, if you don't know from this song, it's built from the words of the Nicene Creed, and Nicene Creed is found in our hymnal on 880. And it's the foundation, and I want to say kind of a I don't want to say simplistic, but I want to say it's a version of a kind of a simple way of saying what we believe in the church as Christians. And we believe in God the Father, we believe in Jesus Christ, we believe in the Holy Spirit, and He's given us new life, that kind of thing. So I wanted to kind of talk about the Nicene Creed a little bit. And the Nicene Creed was began in 325, and the creeds usually, typically, there's a lot of different creeds, but there's the Nicene Creed, Apostles' Creed, and they're in our hymnals, and they're kind of, and there's a different one, but they came out of God, and so it came out of that, and it speaks of that, but the conflict that was going on in faith between Arius and Alexander was, Alexander believed in the divinity of Christ Jesus.
Now we're back.
Sorry, you guys are here. So anyway, that the Nicene Creed, that's where it came out of, this Arian conflict. And they came up in that particular time with this Nicene Creed. And like I said, 381, the Holy Spirit was added to it. So now, is there that conflict still today about the Trinity? You bet it is. I have a good friend of mine that if you even mention the word Trinity, he just flies off the handle. He cannot, he said there's no proof of that in the word Trinity is not in the Bible. So I'm going to tell you that. Don't go home and don't look it up. Don't Google it, whatever. The word Trinity is not in the Bible. But I'm here to tell you that the definition of Trinity is throughout the Bible. And I'm going to get, I picked out four different scriptures for all of us to look at this morning. Colossians 2, chapter 9. For in Christ all the fullness of the deity is in bodily form. In other words, in Colossians chapter 2, verse 9, it is said that in Christ Jesus, God lives in bodily form. In other words, God himself came to us in the verse 14. May the grace of the Lord Jesus Christ and the love of God and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with you all. In other words, the Father, Son, and the Holy Spirit is with you and with me in the Holy Spirit that was gifted to us after Christ left him to the Father. And so in John 14, 26, it says this, but the Helper, the Holy Spirit, whom the Father will send in my, meaning Jesus' name, and bring you to your remembrance all that I have said to you. In other words, God has come to us in the Holy Spirit to continue to teach us and to live with us and to remind us of what Jesus has said all through his life here on earth. And then Ephesians chapter 2, verse 18, for through him we both have our access in one Spirit to the Father. In other words, what I'm saying here to you is that we believe through the Nicene Creed, which is a creed, and there's a lot of different things in the creed. It's kind of, if you go back, like I said, it was written back in 325 and then changed in 381. That's a long time ago. There's a lot of, because it doesn't, it's not that what it says, but it needs to progress kind of thing in what we believe. And so if we take a look at that, all three, and this is just four verses that I chose out of the Bible to share with all of you. Oh, I guess I had another one. I didn't know. 28:19, therefore, go and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit. And now we know that quite often, quite a lot. That's Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. And so there is four times that I chose out of the Bible to talk about the definition of Trinity, and it's very much the definition of Trinity is, and that is the divinity of God through Jesus Christ and the Holy Spirit that comes to us. So now when we sit there and think about that song, when we think about the scripture that was said today, when we think about all of these things, my question to all of us, we believe. In other words, do we believe in God the Father? Do we believe in his Son, Jesus Christ? Do we believe in the power of the Holy Spirit that has come to us? Do we believe that he is the very God among us? See, what I believe is the very Spirit of God that is working within you and I makes the very presence of God a reality for you and I here today as we come together and worship, as we go into those places of suffering. Maybe we suffered in that situation before, but now God is calling us to go into that same situation, maybe in a different place, maybe in the same place. But it is through the power of our God that we can bring the message of the good news of gospel. It's not something that we do ourselves. It is what God, through the Holy Spirit, does within you. God's very presence is within the hearts of those who are believers. So do we believe? Do we believe in the power of God? Do we believe that the Holy Spirit is enlightening us and giving us the knowledge and the wisdom, giving us the strength to go into whatever situation we may be in or have been in to share the good news of the gospel? See, now I believe when I read today's scripture, that's exactly what Jesus is talking about when Jesus questions the Pharisees. Listen, I want you to listen to what happened. We had different conflicts come to where they were being, the religious leaders were being silenced by Christ and his Pharisee. I said the Pharisees came to Jesus with the question today. Pharisee, I want to give you an idea of what this would mean. You like old Western? You ever hear of the old Western where you have the baddest of the bad guys? And you have to hire the toughest of the tough to take out the baddest of the bad. And you spare no money, no expense to get the best of the best. the meanest, orneriest snake in the grass you can find. He's the one that's going to save the day. I want you to kind of think about that for a minute. The disciples of the Pharisees who went and questioned Jesus last week in the scripture were silenced at the end by the question that Jesus asked. Today, the Pharisees, with their six guns on their sides and their black cowboy hat, and they're coming up to cut Jesus, and they said, "We have a question to ask you." And they ask him, "Which is the greatest commandment in the law?" Without hesitation. Now, their reference is that of the Ten Commandments, and I don't want to minimize it to the Ten Commandments only, because there are over 600, I think just shy of 700 in the Old Testament. So out of all of these different laws, what is the greatest commandment? And Jesus says, "To love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, with all your mind." And just like that, to love your neighbor. He said, just like it, love your neighbor as yourself. And so they kind of got silenced for a while, because I think what they were doing is waiting to hear one of the laws from the Old Testament. Instead, Jesus comes, I think he clarifies very well. The law and the prophets have these two commandments. Now, I want you to kind of think about what he's talking about. All the law and the prophets hang on these two, is referring to all of the laws of the Old Testament. These were what the Pharisees lived their life on. No, I want to change that. These are what the Pharisees expected you to live their life on. Doesn't mean they always followed the law. They believed they did. But it's what they expected you to follow the law. And so Jesus says that all of the laws and the prophets, all of the Old Testament, hang on these two commandments. Love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, with all your mind. And love the neighbor, your neighbor as yourself. And so I believe that right at that moment, there's kind of a pause. Maybe a hesitation. And just like that standoff in the Old West out in the streets, before drawing his six gun, he's usually one that got. And that's what happened, because Jesus come back and he said to them, he says, "Yeah, I want to ask you a question. What do you think about the Christ? Whose son is he?" What do you think about us? In the Old Testament, it would have been, what do you think about the Messiah? But in the New Testament, it's, what about the Christ? What do you think? Whose son is he? According to the Old Testament, they sit there and they look at the Old Testament, and says that, you know, he'd be the son of David. This is in reference to the lineage of David. This is in reference to a descendant of David. And the reference that is being made here, and it comes from Psalm 110, verse 1, where David refers to the Messiah who is to come as Lord. He says to his Lord, "Lord, sit at the right hand of the Father," making reference to when Jesus will go back to be with the Father in heaven. And sit at the right hand of the Father in heaven, and the Holy Spirit will come to us. But the Pharisees are interpreting it as the Messiah, or the Christ, would come from and be the son of David. And so Jesus says right away, he says, "How can that be?" And then he makes reference to Psalm 110, verse 1. He said, David is speaking by the Spirit. In other words, the Spirit of God is upon him, and he calls him Lord, for he says, "The Lord said to my Lord, sit at the right hand until I put your enemies under your feet." Think about that. The Lord said to my Lord. They didn't have anything to say.
because what they believed is the Christ or the Messiah was going to come from David. He would be the son of David. But Jesus is saying that it doesn't matter. He's not going to be the son of David. He's going to be a descendant from David. So do we believe? If God himself, through Jesus Christ, said to you and I today, what about the Christ? Who do you think the Messiah is? Do we believe in God the Father, His Son Jesus Christ, and the power of the Holy Spirit? Is God continuing to work through these three, through you and I? See, I believe the very presence of God is with you and I through His Spirit. God is here with you and I today, bringing us together, His Word, giving us the strength to go in whatever place we need to go to share the gospel, whatever place God is calling you to go, to feel the very presence of God and see what He can do through you and I. Jesus is the Christ. Even David in Psalm 110 says, Lord. So we too should say the same. The Pharisees were silenced. Goes on to say, not another question was asked of Jesus after that. He had went through all of the little gunslingers. Now the big guns came. And the Pharisees, and they couldn't even answer the question, what about the Christ? I think it's time for you and I to examine ourselves. Listen to the song. Boldly, that you are the Christ. Do we believe in God the Father? Do we believe in Jesus Christ? Do we believe in the Holy Spirit? Has He given us new life? Has He given you new life? Has He made you where you can profess boldly that He is the Christ? Can you pass it on? Truly knowing how God is at work in your life? Do you truly believe that He exists here with you through the power of the Holy Spirit? Do you believe? I think the question we need to ask ourselves, do we believe as a church? Do we profess boldly that He is the believe that we can go in any situation and speak the word of the Lord confidently, boldly, present His message. Remember, it's not about us. It's about the work within Him. The disciples, I believe, feared going to Thessalonica. They suffered in Philippi. But still, they've confessed that it wasn't about them. It was about the God that was at work within them. And He would give them the wisdom and knowledge. So let us leave here today with the wisdom and knowledge and the strength that comes to us through the Holy Spirit. And profess boldly, not with any doubt, we believe in God the Father. We believe in Jesus Christ. We believe in the Holy Spirit. And He has definitely given us new life. Let's pray. Father God, we thank You and praise You for this day. as we are reminded that we are just tools, obstacles, vessels of your love, your power, your grace. Father, we want to be a church that goes out into the community and we mother others like a mother with her child. We want to go out in the community and let others see the love of Jesus Christ within us. We want to go out in the community and let others see the Christ alive within us. Others to be able to see the presence of the Holy Spirit. We want others to be able to see the power of God at work in our life. We want to see others to see that when we do suffer, we still are lifted up because of the power of our God. Father, it's not all about this life here on earth. This is just an opportunity to share the message of Jesus Christ. It's all about the eternal life. It's living new life. It's living eternally with our Lord, our Messiah, our Christ. And all of that hangs on two commandments. Love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, with all your mind. And love your neighbor as yourself. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.